Good evening, everyone. We'll start with the classes. The today's topic of the class is laser for posterior segment disease. As we all know, the abbreviation, the full form of laser is the light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Starting from the history, the laser term was coined by the Gordon God. Socrates was the first who described the non-laser photocoagulation in 400 before Christ after observing the solar eclipse burns of the retina. The poor will be the father of modern photocoagulation was German ophthalmologist Gerd Meyer Schwickerath, who observed the existence of the scars in the retina of the patient who was exposed to solar eclipse in July 1945. In cooperation with Carl Zeiss Laboratory, Genonarc lamp was constructed and came into use as a first commercial non-laser retinal coagulator in 1959. In 1960, the Theodore H. Maiman developed the first working laser called ruby laser using ruby crystal. In 1968, L. Esperance developed the argon laser. Subsequently, in 1971, NDAG and crypto laser came into market. In 1983, Trockel developed the eczema laser. Now, what are the properties of the lasers? Laser has mainly four properties. The first one is the monochromatic, means the light emits only in one wavelength. Coherence means wavelengths of the laser light are in the same phase in space and time. Collimated means the rays of the laser beam are parallel and unidirection. And polarized, they will be on in one plane. Coming to laser physics, so light consists of electromagnetic waves emitting radiant energy in the tiny packets, which are called quantum or photon. Each photon has a characteristic frequency and its energy is directly proportional to its frequency. When the light is passed to certain kinds of materials, these photons excite electrons around the atoms into the next high energy level. Now coming to the two basic ways the photons and atoms interact. There are too many basic ways. First one is the spontaneous emission and the other is the stimulated absorption. In stimulated absorption, a photon of the right energy gas absorbs and bumps electron into higher energy level. In spontaneous emission, an excited electron falls back to its lower energy level, releasing photon in random direction. A photon strikes an electron, the electron falls to its lower energy level, thus releasing photon that is going in the same direction and in the exact phase with the original photon. Laser is composed of mainly three basic elements. The first one is the optical cavity, around which the medium acts as a resonator. The second one is the lasing material, which can be solid, gas, or liquid. The third one is the pump, which is responsible for exciting the atoms or molecules into the medium, which can be optical, electrical, or chemical. Here is the image which is showing there is a cavity and there are two mirrors. The front mirror is the partial transmitting mirror. The back mirror is fully non-transmitting mirrors. In between there is a resonant cavity. So when the photons are activated by the pump, they circulate in the cavity. Most of the photons are reflected, but some passes through the partially reflective mirrors, which appears as a laser beam. Now, types of the laser depending on the states. The lasers which are in the gaseous states are argon, krypton, helium, neon, and carbon dioxide. In solid states, ruby and NDAG lasers. Copper and gold occur as a metal vapor, and argon fluoride is an eczema laser. The other two lasers are the dye and diode lasers. Now this is the wavelengths, this is the types of laser depending on the wavelength. NDAG and diode is the longest wavelength, which are the invisible lasers. For their use, we have to use another lasers which works as a aiming beam. In visible spectrum, the laser which comes as argon green, NDAG green, dye laser, helium neon laser, krypton laser, and ruby red lasers. Now there are the fundus pigments which absorbs this laser beam. They are the melanin, xanthophyll, hemoglobin. Coming to the melanin first, it has excellent absorption by green, yellow, red, and infrared wavelengths. and it acts as a co-absorber of light in RPE and in choroids. Argon laser, which has a wavelength of 514.5 nanometer, and frequency double NDAC laser, which has a wavelength of 532 nanometer, are the absorbed at the level of RPE and choroid capillaries. Krypton lead and diode laser produce deeper lesion in the choroid, so they cause deeper penetration in choroid and more pain. These all lasers are used in pan-retinal photocoagulation. Coming to the xanthophyll, it's a pigment which is present in the inner and outer plexiform layers of the retina of the macular area. It has a good absorption below but not above the 500 nanometers. It absorbs the blue light maximally and poorly absorbs green light, and minimally absorbs yellow or red light. So in macular photocoagulation, the blue light, blue-green argon laser produces inner retinal damage, causing nerve tissue loss. So these lasers are avoided in the macular photocoagulation. And yellow laser is the most safest laser. So argon green and frequency NDAC lasers are preferred over argon blue-green laser in macular photocoagulation. Now coming to the hemoglobin. Hemoglobin absorbs the non-red wavelength such as blue, green, yellow. It tends to reflect the red light. So these lasers are prepared in patients with cataract and vitreous hemorrhage because they are not absorbed by hemoglobins. These lasers are dye laser, red dye laser, and krypton red. Now coming to the laser tissue interaction, there are mainly three types of laser tissue interaction. The first is the terminal, second is the photochemical, and third is the ionizing. In terminal, there are three different types of reaction. First is the photocoagulation, the second is photovaporization, and photoablation. Photocoagulation is the main focus of today's class. The laser which works by photocoagulation are argon, krypton, frequency double NDAC laser, long pulse NDAC laser, dye laser, and diode lasers. In the photocoagulation, when the laser beam occurs, the laser light hits the target tissue and it generates the local haze, which is about 10 to 20 Celsius, and it denatures the protein. The laser, we have already discussed this, the argon, krypton, dye, diode, and NDAC laser works by mechanism of photocoagulation. There are two operation by which the laser is delivered. The first is the continuous wave and the second is continuous pulse operation. In continuous wave, laser emits their energy into continuous stream of photons over a time. While in pulse operation, the output beams have marked fluctuation so that the beam power changes with time. Pulse duration can range from microsecond to nanosecond to picosecond to femtosecond. And concentrating energy in short pulse duration results in high peak power. Now what is Q laser? In a Q laser, in a resonant cavity, the shutter is placed in front of the fully reflecting mirror, which allows atom to remain in excited state for relatively long time to create high peak power. And it delivers energy pulses of extremely short duration, which are in nanoseconds. By synchronizing the modes with the shutter near one of the cavity mirrors, even shorter, more powerful pulses can be obtained. By adding Q switch or mode lock operation, the energy delivered increases while the time interval decreases. Thus, short pulse and high power laser beam can be generated. Now, coming to the laser parameters, you can see the control panel of the laser system. There are the numbers depicted there. The first laser parameter is the number of photons emitted in each second, which is depicted with the yellow. So what is the power? So power is the number of photons emitted in each second and is expressed in watts. Next to it is the duration, also called exposure time. So it is the photons which are emitted in each burn from the lasers. The third thing is the interval. It is the time duration between two laser spots. And the last thing is the number of spots which are delivered over time. Now coming to the spot size, which is the most important parameter. The diameter of the focused laser beam and is expressed in micron. Spot size is usually fixed for treatment of particular lesion. The spot size when focused on the retina depends on three factors. The first factor is laser spot magnification factor. The second factor is spot size selected in slit lamp. And the third thing is the refraction of the eye under treatment. So the how refraction affects the spot size is that hypermetropic will tend to have smaller burns as compared to the emmetropic eye, and myopic will have a larger burns as compared to the emmetropic eye. So retinal spot size is equal to power of condensing lens in image plane spot size divided by 60. So as example, when you are using 20 diopter lens for pan retinal photocoagulation, it will generate 400 micron spot in emmetropic eye. With increasing diameter, the spot size will increase. Coming to the laser instrumentation, laser is composed of console, control pillar, aiming beam, laser suite, and safety filters. Console contains the laser medium and tube, power supply, and laser control system. Control panel, we have already seen, it contains the dials, push buttons, and touch screen for controlling various parameters. And the three one are the aiming beam, laser switch, and safety filters. Now, what are the delivery system by which you can deliver the laser? There are mainly three delivery system. The first one is the slit lamp biomicroscope. The second one is the laser indirect LIO delivery, in which the main system is the same, but indirect ophthalmoscope is connected with the console. And third one is the intraoperative endolasers. So in slit lamp biomicroscopy laser, the laser is used as mounted with conventional mode of delivery through slit lamp biomicroscope. Advantage is patient in sitting position. It will give more control, precise treatment, and stabilize the eye movements. In LIO is the very convenient for some people. It gives the better patient comfort, increased field of view of retina. It is ideal for pan retinal foveation of peripheral retinal breaks and degeneration. Ideal for PRP scatter foveation of extreme retinal periphery in eyes with like rubiaceous irides, PDR, posterior view, and ROP. Ideal for photocoagulation in children in eyes with small pupil, intraocular gas, and lateral opacities. It is unsuitable for the focal and grid laser of macula because the laser spots are difficult to localize over the macula. The last is the endophotocoagulation, which is used in operation theater. It is done by the fiber optic cable, which is fitted with the laser console machine, producing unit that can be introduced in the eye by means of sclerotomy port. It is ideal for a giant retinal tear. Now the coming to the lenses which are used in pan retinal photocoagulation. So there are five main lenses: Goldman 3 mirror, Manster wide field, Manster PRP, Walk quadrospheric, Walk supercot 160s. Out of all this, the Goldman 3 mirror produces virtual and erect image. The rest of them produces inverted image. Now, coming to the lenses which are used in macular laser photocoagulation. They are the Goldman 3 mirror, Manster standard, Manster high magnification, Walk area centralis. Here we use Walk area centralis more commonly because the image magnification around 1, and laser spot magnification is almost nil. It is which is 0.94. Now coming to the grading of the choroidal burns. Grade 1 is the barely visible blanching of RPE. It is clinically important because it is used in while doing focal or grid lasers. Grade 2 is hazy faint white retinal coagulation. Grade 3 is opaque dirty white retinal photocoagulation. And grade 4 is dense white chalky retinal photocoagulation. Grade 2 to grade 3 burns are used in pan retinal photocoagulation. So before doing any laser procedures, first thing is to confirm the patient. Confirm the MRD number of the patient. Ask the patient his name. Sometimes the patients of the same name can be there. So ask his address also. Go through the EMR, whatever the physician has drawn that diagram and whatever the action plan is there. Explain the patient about the laser procedure and explain him about how his cooperativeness is very important in completing the treatment. Examine the fundus of the both eyes before starting the laser. If you have any doubt, please confirm with the advising physician. If patient has come for the second or third sitting, ask the patient for any complaints or any drop in the vision. Examine the fundus of the both eyes again before starting. Check for the consent. After the laser, prescribe the betnasol eye drops and painkillers if the number of laser burns exceeds more than 500. Enter the register EMR appropriately. Enter all the details appropriate, like laser burns, area lasered, type of laser done, techniques of the laser used, and when the patient has to be followed. Keep the lenses and depressor back into place after the laser is over. Do not twist the cables of the laser as they are very fragile and very costly also. Instruct the patient about their further appointments. Put the laser on standby mode or switch off the machine when laser is not used. Some practical tips to be followed during the laser. Check the laser setting. Make sure that the proper laser cables are connected. Know the orientation. Know where the macula is before starting the lasers. Screen the fundus for exudative retinal detachment, choroidal detachment, especially when they're doing second or third sitting. Start with lower power sitting. Titrate the power as anterior laser may need lesser power. Laser in horizontal meridians often induces pain, discomfort, so reduce the power while doing the laser on that area. Now coming to the photocoagulation techniques, which are commonly used, they are the palmitate photocoagulation, commonly known as a PRP, supplemental or ferritin PRP, sectoral laser, focal, grid or modified grid laser, focal laser for CSR leaks, peripheral laser, and barrage lasers. Now, coming to the indication of laser in posterior segment disorder, these are the main indication which are depicted here, the proliferative diabetic retinopathy, DME, CSR, RVO, which are CRVO, BRV, ME-BRVO, and in case of peripheral retinal neovascular secondary to ROP, FEVR, and sickle cell retinopathy, and in case of peripheral vascular occlusive disease like vasculitis, ileus, and sarcoidosis. So this class was is divided into two parts. So today's main focus of the main focus disease are the diabetic macular edema, PDR, BRVO, CRVO, ROP, and we'll discuss the some recent innovations in retinal lasers. So coming to the laser in diabetic macular edema. So ETDRS was the landmark study who defined CSME. And DME in diabetic retinopathy, DME is the leading cause. DME is the result of microvascular changes in diabetic retinopathy due to incompetence of vessels. It can be caused by both focal or diffuse leakage. The definition of the CSME, which is given by ETDRS, is the presence of any of the following findings. The first finding is retinal thickening within 500 micron or within 500 micron of the foveal center. The second is the hard exudate within 500 microns of the foveal center if associated with retinal thickening. The third one is the retinal thickening greater than 1 disc diameter in size, the part of which is within 1 disc diameter of center of the fovea. Now coming to the conclusion of the ETDRS, what ETDRS has said. ETDRS concluded that the focal photocoagulation increases the chances of vision gain in DME. It reduces the macular thickening. Focal photocoagulation decreases the risk of moderate vision loss by 50%. Now, what are the indications? Indications are mainly three. Focal thickening, diffuse thickening, and retinal avascularity. Now, what are the laser settings when you are doing focal lasers? We can use any of argon green, NDAC, or yellow laser. The areas to be the all looking microorganisms, red spot, or irmas, which are present within 500 to 3000 microns from the macular center. The duration which is to be considered is 0.05 to 0.1 second. Spot size to be kept between 50 to 100 microns. Power is to be set between 50 to 100 millivolt. Intensity is just widening of laser is adequate. Focal treatment up to 300 micron from the macular center should be considered if the visual acuity is less than 20/40 with good perifoveal capillary network. Now this is the fundus image of the left eye showing some hard exudate which is a CSME. So there are three circle dots, there are three red circles which are the hard exudate there. In the same, in the next image, you can see the angiographic image of how the microaneurysms are hyperplosed in the early phase of the angiogram. And this is the post-laser picture, which is showing that how the focal laser burns look immediately after laser. Coming to the grid lasers, in grid laser, all the areas of diffuretinal thickening or capillary non-perfusion up to 500 to 3,000 microns from the macular center should be considered. A laser is the same which is used in focal laser. Our duration is kept 0.1 second. Here the spot size you can keep up to 100 to 200 microns. A 50 to 100 micron spot size is also used for highly thickened retina as the burn is going to expand. A light retinal burn width 1 bit apart and more than 500 micron away from the disc margin is kept. A treatment within a papillomacular bundle should be allowed if it remains in 500 microns from the macular center. Start with the lower setting, usually with 50 millivolt, then gradually increase in 10 to 20 milliwatt to achieve light burn intensity. Number of burns on average 100 to 200 burns are required depending on the spot size. The laser spots are placed one spot size width apart. In grid laser, avoid direct treatment of microaneurysm. Overlapping of burns, particularly over the PM, papillomacular bundles should be avoided because they produce scotomas and of course of foveal burns. This is the upper fundus image is showing the modified grid laser. First, what is the modified grid laser? What is the difference between the grid laser described by ATDRS? So this technique was described by the scientist called Olk. So it is a combination of actually grid and focal laser, in which the focal treatment of all microaneurysms are done, plus grid pattern to fill in the rest of the extent of edema. 100 to 200 burns are placed in a C-shaped manner. You can see this C-shaped manner. Here the picture little hazy, but burns are still visible. And the most important thing is the area of papillomacular bundle is spared. This is how the focal laser or grid laser burns look on different imaging. It is very difficult to find on this normal fundus photography. But red-free image and fundus autofluorescent image can easily identify the laser marks. Now, recently, drcr.net has given guidelines for focal laser. The only, it is almost the similar to the whatever the guidelines was given by ATDRS. The difference, only difference was the burn size for direct treatment is fixed at 50 microns. And change in microaneurysm color width is not required, but at least mild gray-white burns should be evident beneath all microaneurysm. And it has to be applied to all areas with edema, not associated with microaneurysm. If FFE is obtained, grid is applied to the areas of edema with angiographic non-perfusion when just indicated by investigator. Area considered for grid treatments are almost similar. Only this, on temporally, it has to be little away from the fovea up to 3,500 microns. Now coming to the proliferative diabetic retinopathy, DRS was the landmark study which has helped in the treatment of which has suggested that the pan-retinal fovea is the ideal treatment. PRP or scatter photocoagulation universally accepted as a gold standard for laser treatment of diabetic retinopathy. It is well proven that in PDR, laser photocoagulation reduces the chances of severe vision loss by 50%. Now, what is the study questions in DRS was, does PRP prevent severe vision loss in eyes with diabetic retinopathy? So, DRS defined a high-risk PDR, which is any of the following. The first criteria was neovascular in the disc, more than one-third disc area. Any NVD with vitreous hemorrhage or periretinal hemorrhage. And third one was the neovascular elsewhere, more than half disc area with vitreous hemorrhage. High-risk PDR was also defined as three or more of the following high-risk characteristics, which are presence of vitreous hemorrhage or periretinal hemorrhage, presence of any active neovascularization, location of neovascularization on or within 1 disc diameter optic disc. And the fourth one was the NVD more than 1 disc area or NV more than half disc area. The results of the DRS study was that the PRP reduced the risk of severe vision loss by at least 50% as compared to the untreated control eyes. The greatest benefit was seen in the eyes with high-risk PDR. In conclusion, the DRS showed that eyes with high-risk PDR has significantly greater risk of severe vision loss and demonstrated greatest benefit from the PDR. No clear benefit was demonstrated for PRP in eyes with severe NPDR and or in eyes with PDR without high-risk characteristic. PRP reduces the risk of severe vision loss compared with no treatment eye with high-risk PDR that we have already discussed. PRP with eyes with high-risk PDR should receive prompt treatment with PRP. Now coming to the indirect laser, how will you do PRP laser with indirect lens? So wavelength we can use any frequency. We use commonly here the frequency double NDAC laser. We can also use argon green laser. Duration is capped between 0.1 to 0.2 seconds. And spot size on ILO will be around 300 to 400 microns. Intensity is a burn should be around moderate gray white burns. On slit lamp delivery, we can use the transequator or superquad lens. The spot size should be around 200 microns. Duration should be capped at 0.1 second. Start with the minimal power. Start with the least magnification. Identify the fovea first and remain oriented to it. Important tips while doing the PRP laser: always start from the posterior and proceed out peripherally. Create posterior limit by giving laser burns outside the arcade and temporal to the fovea at adequate distance. While doing lasers, never cross the pre-placed burns. Anytime during laser, if orientation is lost or if fundus view is lost, stop the laser immediately. Reorient yourself and then restart. So this is the protocol we follow it at our hospital. The PRP is usually divided over three sessions. Around 1600 to 1800 burns are placed, depending on the aggressiveness of the disease. In the PRP one, this is the optos image, which is showing the usual treatment area for the pan retina fortification. In PRP one, we do the nasal quadrant first. It should be away one disc diameter away from the optic disc, at least till the equator you should do. Around 600 to 800 burns with one bird width apart should be placed. In PRP, we cover the superior and inferior quadrant outside the vascular arcade, at least till the equator, around 600 and 800 burns are placed. In PRP 3, it should be away at least two disc diameter from the fovea. And the same number of burns, around 600 to 800 burns can be placed. This is the schematic diagram how we do PRP in the first sitting. This is the second sitting, you cover superior and inferior quadrant. This is the complete PRP, you place a burn in temporal quadrant. This is how the fresh laser burns looks on slit lamp. They are more uniform, spacing is good, and they are moderate gray white. This is of course the first setting, which the laser burns are placed over the nasal quadrant. This is how the laser burns looks on ILO. It looks little less uniform, and the burns looks sometimes confluent also. So the duration should be increased. Interval should be increased to place more uniform burns. This is the complete PRP. The laser burns are placed all over all the quadrants. This is how the old laser burns looks after. This is the photo taken after 1 year of the PRP treatment. The laser burns are turned into the scars. Now some don'ts. This is optos image of the right eye showing some high intensity confluent burns. There is no uniformity, no spacing. Such treatment leads to high inflammation, subsequently exudative RD and choroidal detachment also. This is the image of the same patient, superior quadrant, and in same pattern there. These are more confluent burns. And this is the image, this is the FFA and fundus autofluorescence image of the parafoveal bones here and some bones within the archer. You can see here this in this circle. So this should be definitely avoided. Now, which are the areas which not need to be retained directly? These are the retinal hemorrhages, major retinal vessels, chorioretinal scars, papillomacular bundle, NVD or elevated NVE, areas of traction RD. Now, this is the DRCR NET guidelines for PRP. It has been given in all the three delivery systems on slit lamp, indirect laser delivery, and Pascal also. So this is just summary of the treatment. This is the one photograph showing the laser treatment away from fibrovascular proliferation. It should be at least 2 disc diameter from the FAV. Now, what is fill-in PRP? The indication as increasing neovascularization, new areas of neovascularization, active appearing NVE, NVD, which are the fine vessels. Active appearing NVE will appear as a fine dilated buds. The tips will be covered with the hemorrhage. There will be new vitreous hemorrhage around the NVD. NVI will be there, NVA will be there. Overall pattern of the treatment will look like, there will be large area between the buns. Two large area of untreated retina will be there. Treatment not extending up to equator. Yeah, either that one of the quadrant has not received any treatment. So these are the indication where you should do supplemental or fill-in PRP. Now coming to the laser BRVO. The retinal occlusion is the second most common retinal vascular disorder after the diabetic retinopathy. PRVO is the most common retinal vein occlusion with incidence of 0.44% to 1.6%. And it is the most common occurrence in supratemporal quadrant, which is 58 to 60%, followed by inferior temporal quadrant, and least common in nasal quadrants. Now, indication of the grid laser in BRVO as the macular edema. Visual acuity is less than 20/40 after 3 months. After 3 months of the occurrence of the vein occlusion, large capillary non-perfusion area which are more than 5 disc diameter, and neovascularization. Now, grid laser is also used for the macular edema secondary to BRVO. The spot size which are kept is almost similar which are used in focal laser for diabetic macular edema. The same spot size, 50 to 200 microns, duration is kept between 50 to 100 millisecond. And grid pattern is placed throughout the leaking area to avoid the edge of foveal vasculogen and peripheral major arteries. So FFA is must to rule out macular ischemia before considering any grid treatment for DME or macular edema secondary to BRVO. Now, the indication for sectoral lasers, neovascular elsewhere or peripheral CNP areas. Laser parameters are almost similar to the which is used in PRP, treatment for proliferative diabetic retinopathy. this is the right fundus, fundus photograph of the right eye, showing the old BRVO, showing some sclerosed vessel here. On FFA, there was a large areas of capillary non-perfusion, usually more than 5 disc diameter. And one image, it is showing some leaking neovascularization elsewhere. And this is the photograph taken immediately after the sectoral lasers, showing the burn placement only in that quadrant which have a capillary non-perfusion area. A laser in CRVO. The CVS study has a few questions that can PRP or scatter laser photocoagulation prevent the development of neovascularization? Can peripheral scatter argon laser photocoagulation prevent vitreous hemorrhage? Can macular argon laser photocoagulation improve visual acuity in eyes with wild macular edema reducing vision to 6/12 or worse? The conclusion where the scatter argon laser photocoagulation could prevent the development of both neovascularization and vitreous hemorrhage to a significant degree. Argon laser photocoagulation improved the visual outcome to a significant decrease in eyes with BRVO, and visual acuity reduced from macular edema to 6/12 to or worse. And the current protocol we follow mostly here is first to do OCT to diagnose or document CME. If there is a CME, anti-VEGF is the first treatment or intravitreal steroid to start with. Repeat the injection if CME recurs with disappearance of retinal hemorrhage. Obtain the FFA after the hemorrhages of the vein occlusion is clear. And if there is a CNP areas, we can do sectoral PRP laser or macular grid laser if there is a macular edema, as described in a branch, a BVO study. Observe if there is a new vasculitis or CRV occurs due to complete anatomic obstruction of the central retinal vein at the level of labina crepitosa. It is of two types, ischemic and non-ischemic. Non-ischemic CRVO, as described in CRVO studies, showed the complete resolution in 10% of cases. Macular edema was resolving in 30% in 6 to 15 months. About 50% about visual acuity was worse than 660 or less. One-third progressed to ischemic CRVO in 6 to 12 months. New vessels develop in 30% in 12 to 15 months. Indication of laser in CRVO is the large areas of CNP more than 10 disc diameter, more than 10 disc diameter, NV and NVD, and NVI and NVA. Laser settings are also similar, which are used in 1-18 folliculation in PDR. So I'm not repeating this. CVO study has recommended that PRP should be delivered promptly after the development of NVI, NVA, but not prophylactically in eyes in non-perfuse CRVO. In 90% of cases, NVI, NVD resolves after 1 to 2 months of PRP treatment. For persistent neovascularization, close observation or additional PRP is required. Patients with NVD, NV should be treated prophylactically to prevent entry segment neovascularization. Now coming to the ROP. It is a disorder of development of retinal blood vessel in premature babies. The normal retinal vascularization happens centrifugally, extending from the optic disc to aura. The nasal aura is completed first by 8 months and temporal aura by 10 months, that is 39 to 41 weeks. Now coming to the revised international classification ROP system, and they have given the three zones. The first zone is the circle whose diameter is double the distance from the macula to the optic disc. The second circle is a concentric around the concentric circle, which is around the zone one, and the third and large. That is okay. And the third zone is the temporal crystal remaining to it. Now coming, there are the stages. In stage one, there is a demarcation line. In the stage two, the ridge appears. In stage three, extraretinal fibrovascular proliferation occurs. In stage 4A, extrafoveal partial RD occurs. And stage 4B, RD involving a fovea occurs. In plus disease, there is an increased arterial tortuosity and venular dilation in two quadrants. Vitreous haze occurs, iris engorgement, and poor pupillary dilation as a common findings. In pre-plus, the insufficient changes to qualify as a plus disease, but more vascular tortuosity and dilation than the normal. So these are the ROP stages. Stage one is the demarcation line. In stage two, demarcation ridge, which has both height and width. These are the pictures of the stage three, which are the extraretinal fibrovascular proliferation. In stage four, partial RD occurs, and stage five is a total RD. What is the plus disease? The plus disease is the presence of any of the following. There will be venous dilation and arterial tortuosity in at least two quadrants. Iris vascular dilation will be there, poor pupillary dilation, vitreous haze will be there. This is the fundus image showing the venous dilation and arterial tortuosity. In pre-plus disease, vascular abnormalities of the posterior pole that are insufficient for the diagnosis of plus disease, but that demonstrate more arterial tortuosity and more venous dilation than the normal. In aggressive ROP, which is called previously as a rust disease, it is a single visit diagnosis. Posterior location is more common, joint 1 or posterior joint 2. It has a plus disease, increased vascular abnormalities in all four quadrants. You can see there is a vascular tortuosity in almost all quadrants. Rapidly progressive fulminant in severe form. Difficult to distinguish between arterioles and venules. There is a direct AV shunting is there. Neovascular may be flat or featureless. Hemorrhage at the junction of vascular and avascular retina. It doesn't progress to international classopic ROP stages of 1 to 3. Typically extends circumferentially and it is often accompanied by a circumferential vessel. It has a poor prognosis. Now coming to the indication of laser in ROP. The first indication is type 1 pre-threshold ROP, which is present in zone, which may be type 1 pre-threshold ROP or worse in zone 1. Any stage of ROP with plus disease or zone 1. Stage 3 ROP without plus disease and zone 2. Stage 2 or stage 3 ROP with plus disease. Now coming to the steps of ROP laser, first explain the procedure to the parents, sign the informed consent. Maximal midriasis is required. Pupillary dilation is done with the ROP drops. Anesthesia is preferred with the local anesthesia or sedation drop. Tropical propragand is few minutes prior to photocoagulation is instilled. Neonatologist anesthetist must be physically present to monitor the vital signs of the babies.
1 second, Dhaval, there is no local anesthesia there. In the Western world, they practice general anesthesia. Local anesthesia, we don't use, mostly topical anesthesia. Local is not given.
Okay.
Or sedation. That sedation also very, very rare. Mostly topical only we'll do. Bigger babies is what we consider for general anesthesia if topical is not. 99% we do only under general anesthesia, not general anesthesia, topical only.
Okay. Then insert the sterilized pediatric lead speculum like Alfonso, Barakar or Sor. Room illumination is darken or semi-darken. This is the photocoagulation system. There are mainly two types of laser which can be used. The first one is the infrared diode laser, and the other is the double frequency NDR green laser. 20 diopter or 28D diopter lenses are used. 28 diopter has a larger field of view. The technique is the assistant holds the head. Surgeon stabilizes the scene between the fog formed by the little ring and middle finger, simultaneously holding the 20D lens with the other two digits. Laser parameters which are used in ROP lasers are start with the 250 millivolts for 150 milliseconds with the repeat mode set at 300 milliseconds. Grayish white bands are preferred rather than white. Power is varied while doing the ROP lasers because the anterior and superior retina will be require less energy. Energy levels need to be reduced by almost 30% to maintain similar grayish white intensity of the burns. In a single session, 3,000 to 400 spots in each eye is delivered in zone 1 or aggressive posterior ROP. 1,000 to 2,000 spots for pre-threshold or threshold zone 2 with non-AP ROPs are delivered. Pattern is nearly confluent or half burn width apart. Photocoagulate the entire avascular area anterior to the mesenchymal ridge up to the oral serrata. Photocoagulation over and posterior to the mesenchymal ridge should be avoided. In severe cases, laser to the ridge or posterior to the ridge should be done. This is the photo immediately taken after the ROP lasers. We can see the entire the avascular area anterior to the ridge is ablated. The burns are nearly confluent or half burn width apart. There are very minor gaps between the burns. This was the case of ROP in stage 2 in zone 2 with plus disease. This is the third case. status force laser and lens sparing vitrectomy. Now some tips which is to be used while doing ROP lasers. For rotation and stabilization of the globe, especially while treating the posterior retina, the instrument, which is either wire rectus or scleral depressor, is held against the fornicial conjunctiva rather than pressing it against the globe. High pressure against the globe causes corneal edginess due to raised IOP or also leads to undesirable rotation of an indentation that make the viewing of the posterior retina very difficult. In addition, hyphema and vitreous hemorrhage can also occur. To visualize the anterior retina, the same instrument is held against the bulbar conjunctiva close to the limbus. In the infant's eye, the ora serrata is 1 millimeter behind the limbus. A common mistake which occurs when the beginners is doing laser is using the depressor 3 to 4 mm beyond the limbus, and is usually done in adults. This leads to difficulty in visualizing the ora serrata. Treating the posterior retina you have to hold depressor against the fornicial conjunctiva. While treating the anterior retina, depressor is held against the bulbar conjunctiva close to the limbus. And treating the anterior retina, the globe must not be rotated to the extreme ends, and an attempt must be made to try to keep it central while using the depressor to bring the anterior retina forward. While treating the anterior retina, the globe must not be rotated to the extreme ends, an attempt must be made to try to keep it central while using the depressor to bring the anterior retina forward. The most difficult areas to focus are the inferior temporal quadrant, mid-periphery and HI. The residual new vessel arising from the inadequate treatment are not common in these areas. What happens if pupil is poorly dilated while doing the ROP lasers? Try and put a few spots in any area even if it is hazy. Simultaneously, the firm sustained pressure must be kept on the globe with the depressor. If view gets hazy during the treatment due to corneal edema, excessive pressure distilled water should be used. It will clear in few minutes after the removal of eyelid speculum. If this doesn't clear, perform laser next day. Wait for 4 to 8 hours until it clears, after which the laser can be completed intraoperative vitreous hemorrhage. The vitreous hemorrhage is an ominous sign, indicates the advanced disease. Ablate as far as possible with the ILO laser along with the supplemental cryoablation. Do not depress too hard and release suddenly lead to pupillary constriction and sometimes intraocular hemorrhage. Start the temporal quadrants first, then proceed superiorly and supranasally. Later return to the temporal quadrant before proceeding inferiorly and inferonasally. Moderate firm pressure that is slowly released avoids corneal edema and hemorrhage and pupillary constriction. Now coming to the modern retinal laser therapy, why the novel retinal laser therapy is needed? Because the conventional retinal laser therapy has a certain side effects like pain, discomfort, decrease in night vision, color vision defects, peripheral visual defects, and the most important is long duration of laser application. And it leads to permanent retinal scarring, which is untoward side effect. Recent evidence has suggested that the reduced intensity and pulse duration leads to less scarring and filling of damaged area. This image is a histological image of the rabbit eye, which is a treatment, which is taken over a 4 months time period. This was the micropulse laser burn, which showed the defect at the junction of RP photoreceptor junction. And these yellow bars indicate the extent of the damage, which is reducing over a period of time. And there occurs a complete healing. There occurs normal physiological restoration of the RP photoreceptor junction. So advantage of this novel retinal laser therapy are no compromise therapeutic efficacy, and they are more selective and more precise. Now, which are the retinal laser therapies? The first and most common is the subthreshold micropulse laser. The second is the pattern scan laser. These two are most commonly used. These are most commonly used among them. And the third is the navigator laser. Fourth is nanosecond laser, retinal regeneration therapy, and endpoint management. Subthreshold micropulse laser has in which the laser energy is applied without scarring or intraretinal damage. Micropulse means the laser is delivered in train of short repetitive pulses separated by quiet intervals. Duty cycle is the fraction of period of time when the laser is on. The on time is the duration of each micropulse, and off time is the interval between them. The duty cycle is set at 5% and power used is 200 milliseconds. This is the mechanism of micropulse laser. You can see the continuous wave pulse laser, the 100% duty cycle is used. While in micropulse, the beam is delivered into envelope of repeated short pulses. There is an off period between times, which allows the retinal tissue to cool down in between, thereby reducing the collateral damage. It selectively targets the RPE, minimize the collateral photoreceptor neurosensory damage. The frequency used is 810 nanometer, which is sub-threshold diode micro-pulse laser, 570 nanometer yellow laser, which is available in our hospital, and then NDAC 532 nanometer lasers. The micro-pulse laser has been used in CSR, DME, PDR, and CME secondary to vein occlusion. The second one is the pattern scaling laser, which is called commonly known as a Pascal. It was introduced in 2006 by a scientist called Blumenkrinz. It incorporates semi-automated multiple pattern, short pulse, multiple short, painless, and precise laser burns in a very short duration in predetermined sequence. The frequency used is double-ag NDAG laser. Pulse duration is kept is between 10 to 20 milliseconds, while in conventional laser is 100 to 200 milliseconds. The laser pulses are delivered in rapid predetermined sequence. It has improved precision, safety, patient comfort, significant reduction in treatment time compared with a single spot photocoagulation. As many as 50 spots can be delivered in 0.6 seconds. These are the different pattern which is used in Pascal laser. This is a fundus photograph which is actually comparing the conventional laser and the Pascal laser, how uniform and how uniform gap is there between the in the Pascal laser, while in conventional laser there are chances of confluent and high intensity burns. Advantages of the Pascals are they have the less collateral damage, more precision of the treatment, decreased pain and increased patient comfort, and reduced treatment duration. Now coming to the endpoint management, it is actually the software in which a model-based Titus algorithm is placed for quantifying laser dosimetry, predictably to precise, optimize the laser power and pulse duration to achieve subvisible retinal laser therapy. It enables grid pattern laser photocoagulation to precisely control low level energy at short intervals, short duration relative to visible titration level. The titration algorithm begins with titrating laser power to a barely visible one. After defining this energy as a 100% nominal energy level, other pulse energies can be selected as a percentage of that threshold. Endpoint management is now commercially available in the 532 nanometer and 577 nanometer Pascal laser. It provides an approach to reproducible subvisible retinal laser therapy. Clinical trials have come which provides the beneficial treatment effects of several retinal diseases such as CSCR, parafoveal telangiectasia, DME, and CME secondary to BRB without detectable retinal damage. Now coming to the targeted retinal foveculation. Targeted retinal foveculation, we select the target areas which are treated in proliferative diabetic retinopathy, in which the opto scanning laser ophthalmoscopy camera with ultraviolet FFA helps the physicians to visualize up to 200 field of view of the retina. Optose angiography serves to guide the Pascal photocoagulation lesion placement in areas of visible peripheral retinal ischemia. No treatment to the better purpose retina is done. Treatment is more accurate with reduced collateral damage. One pilot study is there, which has showed that in PDR while doing this laser, shows the promising procedure with favorable safety profile. Coming to the navigator laser, it is a novel fundus imaging laser treatment device that allows imaging plus integrated laser treatment of the retina, including pattern laser generation. Besides documentation, safety, and patient comfort, the main theoretical advantage lies in the retina navigation. This device offers retina navigation by computerized image and target assistance system, resulting in high precision. It fundamentally differs from the other laser devices by applying not on a slit lamp but on scanning slit lamp based instrument, that is fundus imaging system. This instrument takes approximately 25 images per second in imaging or treatment mode. Because of the slit lamp imaging principle, the images of the high contrast and sharpness can be obtained. This is the fundus image taken while doing the navigator lasers. We can see the Patel laser treatment here. Clinical application in diabetic macular edema, proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and CSCR. The advantage of this navigator laser, they are more uniform treatment, less pain, increased patient component, shorter treatment duration. Coming to the nanosecond laser, normally, the principle of the nanosecond laser is that when the laser pulse duration is more than 4 microseconds, it causes thermal coagulative effects associated with tissue injury. In nanosecond pulse laser, the predominant effect will be more localized, as micro gas bubble formation around the endogenous mesenchyme in the RP leads to subsequent RP damage. The treatment which comes under the category of nanosecond laser is the retinal regeneration therapy, commonly known as 2RT. It is a non-thermal, ultra-low energy, short pulse, 532 nanometer laser as a novel method to delay the progression of early age-related macular degeneration. The nanosecond laser is intended to stimulate biological regeneration of RP in patients suffering from relevant retinal disease such as age-related macular degeneration. Clinical trials have showed that there is a reversal of changes of early AMD, which are like Drusen, pigmentary changes, thickened Bruch's membrane. The results have demonstrated that nanosecond laser has the ability to induce damage to RP cells by microbubble formation intracellularly without secondary thermal spread and collateral tissue damage. Coming to the selective retinal therapy, in selective retinal therapy, we target the RP while sparing the neurosensory retina from thermal damage. It uses repetitive short laser pulses within the microsecond regime, which is shorter than the time needed for produce it to diffuse to the surrounding lasers. The delivered laser energy is predominantly absorbed by mesenchymes inside the RP cells, causing localized high temperature. This results in explosive vaporization and microbubble formation in the RP. It triggers mechanical disruption of RP cells with subsequent proliferation and migration to restore RP continuity and to improve the physiological function of the RP. It has been used in macular disease which are associated with RP dysfunction like CSCR, TME, and early AMD. This is the summary of all novel retinal therapy and the comparison of the various devices and their indication, advantage, and limitation. Thank you.
Only one thing is left out, that is for the postgraduates to answer, what is the biophysics behind the laser? What is the theory behind the photocoagulation? That is one thing which was not covered. So we have left it for you to answer. Any postgraduate can probably answer what is the theory behind photocoagulation. Because this is something which is very commonly asked in exam. Rest he has all covered completely. How does a photocoagulation work in terms of reducing the neovascularization? That is what is the question.
Ma'am, it converts hypoxic retina to anoxic retina. So that will decrease the VEGF flow production and decrease the NV.
That's what. How does it do? What is the damage that is created in the retina which can cause the reversal?
It damages the RP and the choriocapillaries.
Chorioretinal adhesions are created, but what is the thing which is destroyed over there? The photoreceptors, because that is the metabolically active one. So you destroy the photoreceptors, thereby you stimulate the oxygen. So you keep the central area, the macular area, you know, receiving more oxygen. And the another point which you people said was the chorioretinal adhesion. That also helps in crossover of the oxygen. So this is something which you should know, which was actually not covered. So I thought that is one thing to for you all to know. The stimulation of the RP and all, that is by the grid and the modified grid.